Hey there, I'm Albert, and today's video is going to be a little different than usual because I will be reviewing a beta app called Alpaca, which claims to be able to save me a whole bunch of steps in my current Stable Diffusion workflow. Why is that? Well, because the process so far has been generating a lot of images in my web UI and then having to pick one, copy it out, bring it into Photoshop, and then mask, right? You know my process, you know my videos. So it's a bit of a pain. There's a lot of resizing going on. So Alpaca, meanwhile, is a plugin that goes straight into Photoshop. So let's check it out. Now, they recommend in their pretty good documentation that you should have a document around 1024 by 1024. So I'm going to generate that. And immediately you see this little window here on the side. So I'm using Alpaca 1.5.1. So if yours looks a little different, that's why. And there's a cute little logo. Here you see the credits you have because it's not running locally on your GPU. It is using an online service. So that's very helpful, of course. If you don't have a super strong GPU, you get faster results from an online source. Now the first button here is guides. If you click on that, you get this little window and then have the docs. So that's helpful. Getting started, documentation, how to install and so forth. That's pretty neat. Then next you have the possible commands. They have three. There is imagine, fill, and transfer. Imagine is kind of the standard prompting image generation. They have a couple templates here. Manga, cyberpunk, matte painting. So that's kind of cool. If you click on one, you get a good suggestion. And they've split up the prompt into prompt and modifiers, which I find pretty helpful for structure reasons. So up here you pretty much describe your scene. So let's say a castle on a green hill with storm clouds above. And down here, this is what I would do with commas in my normal workflow. So you have matte painting in the style of Josef Toma. Interesting. Let's check if that artist is living or not. I think that's a classical painter. Yeah, Vienna, Austria. So wonderful. We're not taking anybody's style who's trying to make a living with it. Beautiful, sure, high quality. Two, there's weights after these numbers are the weightings, how important you think it is. Epic lights and trending on ArtStation. So you can edit whatever you want. I like, for example, cinematic. And here you edit the number of images you want. It goes from 1 to 5. So let's do 4. Prompt strength, I usually do 7.5. Kind of hard to... Seed up here, we're going to leave that, and quality 50, and here you see how many credits it's going to cost you. So go, and this is a good point to tell you that I got 200 credits for this. I'm not getting paid for this review. They gave me 200 credits to test it. Down here you see the process. I'm not going to skip through that so you can see how fast it is. There's a little indicator down there. Remember, we're generating 4 images right now, so my computer would definitely be slower with its 2070S graphics card in there, which I know is not a super fast consumer graphics card. And now there's another little loading window, and here you see what it did. So it generated me 4 different versions that it put on separate layers, put them up there in the corner. And before you start clicking down here in generations, you see that you can just easily switch between the generations. Then you have 3 settings, a little check mark here, 2 check marks, and an X. The first check mark accepts this one generation and deletes all the others. The second check accepts all of them and leaves them as layers here, and the X just deletes all of them. So that's kind of helpful. I'm going to pick one. Yeah, let's work on this one. We have a little landscape to do. So I hit the check, and as expected, it deletes all that. And now we can bring this into the middle here. And we can edit some stuff. So fill is basically in painting, I suppose, if you know what that means. So I select a part that I don't like and have it change. So let's actually, let's edit our little castle here. So the way they say to do it in the documentation is to select the layer, get the eraser, and actually just erase the part you don't like, and it will recognize what you want changed. And it wants us to use the marquee tool, set to style fixed size. Right. So what I saw in the documentation is that the fill feature requires 1024 by 1024 size. So I'm not super sure why, but I think we may have to set that. And what that does is it just gives us a whole option. So I have the whole thing selected, basically. So I don't know why they recommend the dimensions of the total file to be 1024 if your fill is going to require that too. So might be a mistake in the documentation, just a little weirdness. But it's a beta. So let's have the layer selected, go to fill, and there's an error. Part of your selection is out of the document bounds. Okay, but it's the whole document. Okay, so I can't go any smaller than that. I guess I just kind of have to upsize my canvas. Well, let's do 2048. Just go out of the way to accommodate this and select again. Okay, well, we're probably going to get a whole bunch more than just this. Go to fill. And now the selected area must be smaller than 1025. Okay, but the documentation literally says that if I want to fill an image, the marquee tool must be of size 1024 by 1024 for fill to work. So if I go smaller, I'm not allowed to have this size. So let's do 512 and see what happens. They got a lot going on making an app like this. I get it. No worries, guys. Come on. There we go. So now I can select what I want and hit fill. There, it's working. Template, we had the matte painting. It would be nice to kind of have the modifier just copy from your previous prompt, right? Because now it's deleted the stuff I want from my other one. I guess I can copy them from here. And fill, paste. Okay, so let's change it. Let's do a Victorian mansion on a hill and have it give me four different options. The image size is 518 by 518 now. I don't know what happened there. It's kind of strange. And 7.6 credits. So, go. I'm going to skip through this because you know how long it takes now. Okay, so what it did, first one doesn't have a mansion at all in it. That's a stable weirdness. I don't blame Alpaca. 2, 3, 4. Okay, that's the most mansion-y. It's kind of hiding behind the bush, but has like a big flag up there. So we're going to take that one. Now, I'm not quite sure, but the way I've understood it is actually that you should use the other feature, the transfer command, to put in different items. So the fill is more to remove things or just fill it in. That's why it's called fill. So I'm going to be fair and say it's just a green hill landscape and click OK. And it did perfectly, right? Of course, it just extended the bush in different variations. That one looks like it's trying to hide something. Yeah, so nice. Let's take that one. So what I've realized has happened now is that I got a frame as well because it was set to 518 by 18, not 12. So you can see around it, it got this little frame that I can actually erase now. So I'm back to erasing things manually like my other workflow. So that's not great. I assume it's just a slight little error on their part that someone entered 518 instead of 12. So happens to the best of us, but I assume that's a simple fix for them. And now they also recommend merging layers regularly and cleaning up a little so you don't make mistakes and do stuff on the wrong layer. So now we move on to transfer, which is supposed to change objects slightly. And they say you can change the marquee style back from fixed size so you don't have to have this big square anymore. You can do anything for this feature. So that's kind of cool, which is why I'm going to do a really small little change here and select that. And go to transfer. And they say you can do a very simple description. You don't need all the modifiers and stuff. This is quite simple. So I'm going to do a Victorian mansion. Image size, that's the size I selected. Okay, that's very small. So if they're just sending that through stable, I'm curious about the results. Maybe they're making a big one and sizing it down. That's entirely possible. So that would be good. Let's do 2, transfer strength, all this. I assume this is just image to image, what I do usually. So that would be kind of cool if that's what it is. And strength. This is probably inverted from the denoising strength, I assume. If you've seen my other videos, denoising strength, the higher it is, the more creative it gets. So, no, that's the same. It's the same direction. Transfer strength, I assume if the transfer is really high, it can do whatever. So let's try that. Okay, it for sure made a Victorian mansion, and my transfer strength was just way too high. So that's on me. Let's delete that. Make a similar selection and set it lower. It made a little mansion, sure. It added the frame again, though, I gotta say. So there's some error going on that they make their results a little too big. You can see there's just this little frame around here. So I end up having to go and feather this. So I guess it would be a little smarter if they, somewhere in their software, feathered the result on the edges. Like what I do in Photoshop, basically, I mean, my masking isn't super advanced. I just kind of feather the edges, right? And that will make it integrate into the result much quicker. So if you have some simple way of programming that, I'm not a programmer, but that would be what I would try. So pretty decent. We've removed a castle. We've put in a little Victorian mansion that does look like it was downscaled. So I think they did the right thing, made a big result and shrunk it down instead of just using that resolution straight in stable. Generally, I'm pretty happy with this. It does what they say it does. The bugs make it a little annoying to use, but I'm sure those will be removed before they release this, because obviously it's still a beta. And one more thing I'm curious about is if they do anything to the prompts. So I'm going to use my local installation of Stable Diffusion and imagine the same thing and see if they change some things around or are using a different model. Now, I don't know what sampling method they use and what the seeds are, but so far it looks like they're using a normal version of Stable Diffusion. The results are quite similar to my prompt, which of course is helpful to know. So I'm not missing anything by using Alpaca as opposed to my local version of it. So here are the results of my own generation. I'd say that's fairly similar to what we got here in Alpaca. Now, of course, what I appreciate in my web UI here is I see the images as they're generating, so I know what's happening, if it crashed or not. Here I'm kind of often just sitting and waiting for it to start, which I think psychologically is not great, right? I kind of want as a person to see what's happening, that something's working. So that's a neat little feature that's in the web UI here that I don't get anywhere else. Otherwise, I mean, I have some more features here. I have the restore face, I have a tiling option, all the stuff that automatic 1111 entered here into their version, which is really neat that I don't have in Alpaca, but some of those are advanced features, right? If you're a Photoshop user and you just kind of want a neat little extra powerful feature in your normal Photoshop work, I'm sure this is much, much cooler. So generally, it's a cool tool. I don't think I'll be integrating it into my workflow quite yet because I like some more manual control and, of course, the bugs with the weird frame and the 1024 not working with fill, but then working, but then not working. So all kinds of stuff like that, I'm sure they're going to fix soon. So generally, thank you so much to the team at Alpaca for letting me try out the beta and make this video. If you want to get on the wait list and try it out soon, just go to getalpaca.io and sign up here, and I'm sure you'll get access quite soon. So that was it for now. I'm personally very excited to see what comes of this tool, what other tools become available as people start learning about this amazing open source opportunity called Stable Diffusion. And until then, as usual, if you like this video, please subscribe, please comment what you want in the future. I'm very responsive and I love getting your ideas for what you want to see. Leave a like on this video, and I hope to see you soon. I'm Albert Bosazan, and till then, have fun with Stable Diffusion.